Hey, how you doing?
Awesome. So we're really excited that everybody's joining us. We're going to wait a few more minutes. But for those of you who have logged into the webinar a few minutes early, you have a special treat. I'm going to ask David to talk a little bit about the film that he's been working on when we begin the webinar. But David, I was wondering if you could just tell people a little bit about what led you to the creation of this film. So for the people who are here a couple minutes early, give us a little bit of background, and then we can talk about the film itself when we begin the webinar.
Well, I'm in Atlanta, Georgia, and the problems here are also, you know, sort of nationwide. But here there is a lot of push toward anti-bullying, and there are a lot of us in the film community. I'm a filmmaker by trade. A lot of us in the film community who are trying to address those issues and see some of those issues in the, you know, like the middle school and the elementary school and high school setting as precursors for a lot of what you're seeing now in the entertainment industry when we're starting to talk about like the sexual harassment piece is a smaller part of a larger thing where people are abusing power and things like that. So myself and a lot of other filmmakers are trying to use, you know, our voice to sort of creatively address these things in a way that's not necessarily preachy, but also very entertaining, but enough to spark some of the conversation toward finding better ways to teach young people to deal with their own feelings as far as like what would lead them to be a bully, or how they can deal with bullies, or how we can, you know, sort of help that situation too, just as a creative community and as mentors to youth and things like that. So that's what led me to starting to, you know, make this short and try to see what I could do to put it out there and spark some conversation.
There we go. We still have another minute or two before the official start of the webinar, but, you know, you're talking about your interaction with other people in the film community. Mm-hmm. I'm really curious how much contact filmmakers have with each other. So you're in the Atlanta area.
Correct.
What's that like, and how do you think that compares to New York or Hollywood in terms of filmmakers' sense of social responsibility and the communication they have with one another?
Well, the Atlanta film community, right now Atlanta is the number one film community in the country. It goes back and forth, and that's largely because of the tax credits and tax incentives more so here. Tax incentives and tax credits. At any rate, so a lot of films that are even being financed out of LA and New York or coming here to have those films made. But consequently, a lot of the bigger studios are actually setting up. Screen Gems has a studio here, Pinewood. A lot of those major ones are setting up shop here as, you know, as a satellite place for them to come and make movies because they're making so many. But what that's also doing is raising the bar for those of us here who are independent filmmakers. So that community is really sort of close-knit. We know and share a lot as far as working on crews for each other or taking some ideas from other people and helping them to expand them and things like that. So that film family is growing. And I have not spent a lot of time making films in New York or LA, but what I will say about Atlanta is just, I think things like the history of civil rights and things like that make people here a lot more, artists here anyway, a lot more socially conscious and a lot more moved to do things and use their art to impact social issues. And a lot of those social issues now are surprisingly not just along like racial lines or something. There are a lot more universal issues like bullying or, you know, just how we treat each other and how we deal. And a lot of the movies that people are making are more human interaction movies. So there's a lot of drama or comedy even in, say, your relationship with me and mine with you or whatever, where we don't have to blow up cars and topple buildings to really touch people, you know. Yeah. So I think people are using that sort of independent platform to talk about issues that can impact people, like I said, like bullying and like, you know, just how my actions affect you and consequently the greater good. So.
Oh, that's fantastic. It's heartening to hear that. It really is. I think, you know, it's certainly true that artists have always been shapers of social fabric and culture. So it's wonderful to hear that that's happening. It is a couple minutes after one, and I'm grateful that so many people have joined us live for this webinar. Others will get an opportunity to watch the recording, but I want to welcome everybody to the webinar. You can see in the webinar room, you have an opportunity to post a chat. You can say hi to everybody and say where you're tuning in from. But I'm delighted to welcome everybody, and especially today's guest, David Conley, who is a professional filmmaker. He is also on the Expert Online Training faculty. Many of you who are tuning in today have seen his handiwork and appreciate the view that he has on the important relationship between youth leaders and the young people they serve. And so our topic today, and you heard some of our sort of preliminary discussion, was about the film that David's making that's soon to debut. It's called Father's Day, and I'll let David talk about himself and a little bit about the film in a minute. But just two housekeeping details. If you've got a question, you can enter it in the chat room, and I'll try to keep an eye on that. And so if you see me glancing away from the camera and looking down at the corner of my screen, you'll know that it's because I'm attending to your questions. And the second housekeeping detail is if your video starts to hitch a little bit on the receiving end of this webinar, where you're sitting in front of your computer or mobile device, you can make that video flow more smoothly if you shut down other programs on your computer and if you turn off other devices that may be using Wi-Fi signal, such as your phone. We will end promptly at 1:30, but you'll have the opportunity to rewatch this webinar or share it with your colleagues, because Webinar Jam, which is the platform we use, will send you a link to the recording, and we encourage you to share that with others. So without further ado, David, You are a professional filmmaker and a member of the EOT faculty. I'm keen to hear a bit about this new film that you're working on, not for Expert Online Training, but that is a professional short. Tell us about it, and tell us, you know, everything that everybody wants to know. When can we watch it? What's it about? And specifically for today's topic, what'd you learn about bullying? Because I gather that this is part of what this film is about.
Okay, so quite a few questions. First, for those of you who don't necessarily know me, Dr. Thurber mentioned I am a professional filmmaker here in the Atlanta, Georgia area. Made features before, of course, and also, you know, several shorts, and a lot of what we like to do at my company, Munira Entertainment, Munira means one who enlightens. So we like to make movies that entertain, but that also sort of provide a message, but not in a beat you over the head, you know, sort of way, but entertain you, move you, and through that, you know, hopefully enlighten you and open your minds to different things that are going on, and maybe different points of view with regard to that. To that end, we are making in post-production now, actually, on a short called Father's Day. And Father's Day is, it's a short that deals with bullying and also deals with just emotional management. And it's like how some mismanaged emotions have sort of gotten out of control and out of hand. And so we're sort of dropped into a very hostile situation dealing with an active shooter at a school. But the active shooting situation is the result of a bullying situation that went on before. So we are trying to spark the conversation about bullying, about the thing that may have led to this other thing, by like a really dramatic sort of story about this father who feels like he's at his wits end on how to deal with this. He's getting closed doors everywhere he goes, trying to get it handled what he would consider the right way. And it's not working out for him, or hasn't worked out for him. So by the time we see him or meet him, he's dealing with it in a completely inappropriate way. But a lot of those concerns about what he's feeling, what he's going through, what his son has gone through, and everything gets brought out and addressed. And questions get raised that the audience will then be able to take away and wrestle with, try to think about ways to sort of stop this thing from happening in the first place, and just how we deal with treating each other like everybody has merit and everybody's point of view has worth, even if you don't particularly agree with it. Different doesn't mean deficient. And so that's kind of the overall message of what we're trying to get across with the movie, where you'll be able to see it. Our initial thing is to, once post-production is done, we have targeted several high-level festivals, mm-hmm. including Sundance, Tribeca is wow. another one. We're shooting for them. We are not in yet, of course, because the movie has to be finished for us to submit it. But
sure.
We think we stand a pretty good chance of getting into some of those. Also, the American Black Film Festival is pretty good. When the Atlanta Film Festival here, which is a precursor to the Oscars, we're just trying to get into some of these festivals, hopefully make some noise. And then with that noise, we'll be able to use that PR to say, okay, here's what it's about. Here's right. what we think about things like bullying and active shooter situations and that kind of thing. And then we can continue or add our voice to the ongoing conversation about those things. So
that's wonderful. So it's both a true to the name of your company, Munira. It's enlightening, but it's also a way to spark conversation.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah. So tell me this. You know, we boldly titled this webinar New Insights on Bullying. Mm-hmm. And I know before you and I entered the webinar room, we had some conversations about, as fathers, both of us are fathers. You know, we're both invested in education, not just for our own kids, but of youth leaders around the world. In your research and in your production of this film, what new insights did you gain about bullying? I feel like so many bullying programs or anti-bullying programs in schools are focused on how to respond when a bully does X, Y, or Z. And lately, how to teach bystanders to intervene. And that's wonderful. It's been great research and it's diminished the frequency of bullying, but obviously it still happens. I don't think it will ever get down to zero, but you talked when you were describing the film about this, the sort of story that you're giving the audience about going all the way back to maybe where this began. Mm-hmm. What did you learn about bullying and where it sometimes begins? What's the kernel from which it germinates?
And then that's a great question, because a lot of what I initially found when researching this and putting the, because I wrote the script too, putting the script together, was dealing with once the fire has started, how do we put it out, you know, or that kind of thing, where I think a lot of people miss the mark just in interpersonal communications in general, mm-hmm. Is that they don't deal with the day-to-day before, you know, like I always hear the saying, there's no such thing as a maintenance-free garden. So like the best time to deal with some of these issues is when they are potentially little weeds that may grow up, you know, in the garden. But when it's big weeds that are choking things out or are taking over the ground, then everybody wants to jump in and have this emergency. And that's necessary. But I right. guess I'm saying that what I learned and came away with is what is potentially more powerful thing to use against bullying is just teaching people that I don't have to, that we can have a win-win situation. In other words, I don't have to make you lose in order for me to win. And that right. even though I may be good at whatever this is, you're good at something else that I don't normally look at as saying this is, this makes this person worthy of, you know, respect and what have you. Like if I'm a jock, I may not think theater, for instance, is a thing that I would pursue or whatever, but starting to get people to look at how some of the same things that you would go through as a football player to be excellent in that, a person in theater has to go through. And so in that, there's common ground, you know. Yeah. And so when you start thinking about different things like that, especially when you're talking about young people, as they get older, you'll start to realize when you get out into the world that it takes, as the cliche said, goes at all kinds to make a world. There's merit in everyone's talent. And so I think to start the changing of young people's minds, even at something as small as kindergarten, to yep. be able to have them to see that everybody's contribution is worthy of respect and what have you. When you start doing that, it's harder to look down on people. It's harder to treat them as if they are somehow disposable, and that you can look at them as something that you can like exercise your inadequate feelings perhaps on, or your superior feelings one way or the other, right. you know. But also it can, I think when you teach young people that kind of thing, it also goes against what they might be feeling. Cause a lot of times bullies are people who are being bullied themselves in another arena, maybe at home yeah. or somewhere else, but they can start to think that, hey, maybe there's another way to think about this entire paradigm. And maybe they can or cannot affect where they're being bullied, but they can certainly affect not passing that on once they're able to see everybody with some sort of merit. So I think it's important to teach that to young people, the younger the better. I think there are a lot of exciting ways to do that from very young to, you know, even high school age and what have you. And once you start doing that, I think people will have a lot more just general respect, baseline respect for people. And I think that's something that's lacking even in adults these days, you know, the current climate with the country. There's a lot of things that's not about we are all worthy of respecting each other and making this place better together. Instead, it's more, I am great. No, I am greater. No, I am great. You know what I mean? And that kind of thing sort of promotes like an antagonistic and bullying friendly environment, you know.
Well, it's fascinating what you're saying, because I think that one of the things that youth programs, whether it's a camp or Parks and Rec department or summer school, is really excellent at doing and well suited to do, maybe because the atmosphere is a bit more relaxed in mm-hmm. the summer than it is during the school year, but schools can do this as well. Not focus entirely on what are going to be the consequences for bullying, or not focusing entirely on making sure that people can spot it, whether those are the youth leaders or the teachers or the participant bystanders. But if we go all the way back to the beginning, and you know, you're the first person that I've heard ever say this, you know, bullying prevention program mm-hmm. might look like teaching people that, you know, a difference is not a deficiency, as you said, that there are many situations that can be win-wins. You know, there's one open swing on the playground and you and I both want it. There's certainly a way to look at that where, you know, whichever of us is the fastest is gonna get there first and they get it. But there's a whole nother way of looking at it, which is that swing is available to whoever wants it in a equitable kind of turn-taking, you know, scenario. You don't have any greater right to that swing, or I don't have any greater right to that swing. And I think you're absolutely right. It's even before kindergarten that we can start teaching kids about their own, you know, self-worth and other people's worth, and take as many different opportunities as we can to teach kids how much fun it is to get to know about other people's differences. You know, mm-hmm. I'm pretty good at this and you're pretty good at that. But even that sometimes is viewed by little kids and big kids as a sort of, like you were saying, it's a lot of one-upmanship or one-up-womanship, but it's the idea that one of us is going to come out on top. And instead, you know, you and I are both friends with Naomi Jaha Eccles. She talks a lot about not just recognizing that there are differences, but actively teaching other people what it is that you're good at and actively trying to learn from other people what makes them interesting and special and what they're good at. And I think you're absolutely right. Like if we could do that in our schools and camps and other places, we would dramatically lower the intensity of any form of disrespect, you know, bullying, hazing, you know, you mentioned sexual harassment, which is obviously making headlines lately. And
It has to be, not to cut you off, Doc, it has to be something that you teach young people is just their whole paradigm. Like that win-win is just a complete, total philosophy, only way that they think about that situation. Because right now, you know, when I was growing up, it was like that. You get a swing and you and I both want it, I have to get not only like where I get to swing, but I have to swing the entire recess. You know what I mean? And you have to not, in order for me to, that added some kind of way to the enjoyment. And it's taught that way. And certain things, it's appropriate, I guess, in sports, some of the win lose thing is important there. But I guess what I'm saying is, even with some of that, you're not necessarily learning from the loss. It's just either the shine or the shame. You know, those, that's the only, you know, options. And so it needs to be a thing, I think, where we are teaching. And it's funny, interesting, that in the film community, see, it's important because everybody wants the marquee roles. They want to be the lead actor, or they want to be the director, or they want, you know. But what they may really be good at is cinematography, which... Mm-hmm. And so in that way, you know, I know a lot of people who think in terms of this shot only, not how this shot fits into the whole film, but in terms of this shot. So rather than them learning themselves and realizing that when I think like that and I think about perfecting this shot, but I'm completely oblivious to how it fits into managing a whole thing. Maybe I'm a great cinematographer and that's what I should pursue. And when they pursue that, there is enough pride for them in doing a great job as a cinematographer, as opposed to trying to, for the sake of this other glory, put themselves in a job where they're not as good and where they're up against people who think like this and are directors. You see what I'm saying? Since they have such little regard for that, they get into a win-lose situation in an arena where they don't even qualify, you know. So some of it is about teaching young people to learn themselves, teaching them to listen to other people and to hear, you know, what's beyond being said, even, and get to know Chris, and Chris gets to know David, and in doing that, then we start creating some really great things together, because I'm good at this but you're great at that, and so the two of us together will create a lot better things and a lot more, impacting things than we will individually. And that's something you do learn on film crews. You learn that, you know, this, when everybody gets together and does what it is they do good, and you are able to, you know, maximize all those gifts for one big project or even a short like this, you know, you come away with some really, really incredible things.
You know, it makes me think from a practical standpoint, which is something I'm always trying to imagine. This series that we're doing this year on staff training is not so much endowing the participants in the webinar with concrete skills that they can immediately bring, to the ground level, but getting them to think if our target audience here for this series is camp owners, directors, senior staff, getting them to think, as you're articulating right now, a little more broadly about what gets emphasized and how we want to conceptualize things. So what occurred to me when you were talking was, you know, for the directors and senior staff who are participants in this webinar right now, think about how you frame competition in your program. And, you know, there's nothing wrong with, if you're playing a game of tennis, having there be a winner and a loser, but how is that emphasized? And what's the way that a competition is talked up prior? And do you endorse, you know, this kind of trash talking ahead of time? How are things refereed during the competition? And then at the end of the competition, I always loved so much what we did at Camp Belknap, the camp where I grew up. The winning and the losing teams gave each other a cheer. And if it was done the right way, you couldn't tell by the level of enthusiasm of the cheer, you know, who was the winning team. And kind of, you know, you left it all on the field. It made me think about competition. It made me also think about how owners and directors of youth programs formulate and give advice to their staff about how to create a really welcoming opening day. We sometimes think about the get to know you exercises and the little icebreakers, the name games and things like that as trivial, and you know, gets kind of perfunctory treatment. We're just going to do it. Okay, everybody knows everybody else's name, and then go. And what you don't realize is, wait a second, that was your anti-bullying opportunity, right. You know, of the session, because as soon as I get to appreciate you and you get to appreciate me for something more than just our names, now we're not going to judge each other in the same way we might have if we stayed unknown to one another. Absolutely. You know, so if people give people a bunch of marshmallows and dry spaghetti and have them build some, you know, creation, it's not just that it's fun. It's that, as you were saying, it's requiring some cooperation in the same way that a film crew has to work together to, you know, make this creative project and try to reach some common goals. You know, that is, it's such a wonderful, like, kind of social lubricant. There's not the kind of tension, there's not the kind of prejudice, there's not the kind of disrespect that is going to increase the likelihood of bullying and so forth.
And it gets you used to the thinking that's required to look into a person and see, you know, like the many faceted ways that they are valuable. Yeah. You know what I mean? Yeah. It gets you used to, a lot of us aren't used to that. We're used to looking at you as competition. And so therefore I'm trying to see how I can downplay you and make myself feel better and that kind of thing, as opposed to really making a habit out of trying to see, you know, he's really good at this, this, and this. And saying that he's really good at that or she's really good at that does not diminish how good I am at whatever I'm doing. Right. So then you're not afraid to, you know, to do that. So yeah, those exercises, you give them a lot more emphasis because you are teaching the young people to do that as a default. And that's, you know, that's crucial.
And it's interesting because, you know, when you do all that, you haven't even said the words bullying and you haven't done a lot of finger wagging and told kids what to do and not do. You're just nurturing the kind of connections that are, like you said, they're kind of pulling the little weeds early on, and you don't have something grow into, you know, something enormous. So we're gonna dive a little bit deeper into that in the last 5 minutes that we've got, but an exciting quick break is a giveaway of two $50 gift certificates from one of Expert Online Training's longtime sponsors, and that is everythingsummercamp.com. Nice. Many of you know everythingsummercamp.com is a website that, as the name suggests, provides supplies for kids at camp and summer youth programs, and they make the best trunks in the world. I stake my reputation on that. And so we've drawn two names at the beginning of the webinar, and they've just come up, and they are Benjamin Stair and Jenna Dorschner. So I will be sending Benjamin and Jenna, congratulations. You guys each win a $50 gift certificate from everythingsummercamp.com. I also will remind people that when we wrap up in a few minutes, I will post in the chat room the link to the trailer for Father's Day, the new film by David Conley that's due out soon. And I encourage you to take a look at it. It's definitely, it's a good teaser, David. I mean, it makes, made me want to like, okay, where is it? Where is it? You're like, oh, it's not out yet. It's not out yet. So one last question I have for you is, what do you hope something like Father's Day is going to get people to think about? You know, we've talked about social connection. We've talked about appreciating other people's differences. The film itself, as you said, involves a school shooting or an armed shooter, active shooter. You know, obviously that's a scary topic. It makes people anxious. Most bullies don't turn that violent. Mm-hmm. You know, it's probably not just one conversation, but what are the kinds of conversations that you're hoping people have after seeing Father's Day?
I'm hoping that they are able to, let me go back. What we try to do with the movie, when you see the teaser, you'll kind of see like the broad strokes of what the challenge is with the active shooter and things like that. But a lot of times what we don't know or think about is how that person got to that place. So right. What I'm hoping is that when you watch it, you'll start to understand, you know, a lot of the things that went into how these characters got to this place. And I'm hoping that in that you will see just sort of the human part of it for everybody, for the bullied and the bully, for those people who are reacting to it. And I'm hoping that when you look at this, as extreme as it may seem, you'll then say, well, how can we, like, you know, work to prevent this or severely minimize it and start back like where we were talking about before? You'll see the importance of the prevention opposed to trying to react to it on the on the back end. So that's, I'm hoping that when you see the big fire, that you'll start saying, well, maybe if we get rid of a lot of the fuel for the fire, we will have less fires. And so that's the kinds of conversations that I'm hoping we're able to have.
And do you think Father's Day, how long does that film run? And is it an appropriate film to show a camp staff? Again, most of the folks who are joining us today are owners or directors of camps and other summer youth programs. Is it a good way to spark a conversation about what we've been talking about today? Looking at respect and cultivating respect and appreciating and celebrating differences as the best sort of preventive medicine? Or do you think it might not be appropriate for camp staff?
I don't know that it would be entirely appropriate for camp staff as far as showing it. And then it's one of those things, like if you have seen the movie, and then you want to talk about some of the themes of it. Yeah, but I'm not so sure I would say that it is. I mean, there's a bit of language in it and some other things. So for that reason, I would think that you would have to be pretty broad in your thinking to say, okay, I'm going to show this, and then we'll directly have that conversation in a camp setting. Film festivals and things like that, or being able to show it online and then have those conversations is a little bit different, but some of the things that it impacts directly to me can be affected by staff at camps and things like that. Sure. I would encourage camp directors and youth leaders to watch it maybe on their own, but to spark just that thinking of how do I not create this situation, or how do I help to prevent that sort of situation from happening by changing first my thinking, but then also hopefully the way I deal and model this behavior becomes an example to others that they would do that same thing. So that's kind of more the.
All right, well, that's great advice. And maybe something that, you know, our viewers can think about is in their preseason correspondence with their incoming staff, making a few resources available, including your film, and if it is available, you know, to the public. But there could be other films or other media clips or things like that. But a menu of offerings. But get, as you were saying, the staff to think about what could we do this summer to enhance the connections among kids, right from the moment they first arrive on the property,
exactly,
to set a tone of both respect and teach that conflicts can be win-wins. It mm-hmm. doesn't have to be a win or lose. And I will direct people to the one of the many videos you've created for expert online training. I'm thinking about the one you created called No Losers that teaches youth leaders how to cultivate this win-win mentality, and Scott Arizala's two modules called We Squashed It, which illustrate collaborative problem solving for either physical conflict or emotional conflict, relational aggression, if you will. So, well, we are, that went too fast. We're out of time. It's just past 1:30. Let me make sure that I put up in the follow-up email to everyone, you'll get, because I realized I can't just post it here in the chat room, that'll all disappear when I click on webinar over. But in the follow-up email that you'll get in a couple of hours, you'll have a link to the recording for this webinar. You'll also have the URL for the trailer to Father's Day, David Conley's upcoming film. On behalf of David and me, Chris Thurber, we're grateful that you were able to join us. And for any of your colleagues who weren't, send them the link to the recording. It's been a fantastic and enlightening discussion for me, David. Every time it's great to be your friend, and it's great to have you join us for one of our webinars. So thank you very much, and thanks to the participants. Yeah, and you can check out on our website, expertonlinetraining.com, the schedule of upcoming webinars. We'll do one a month up to the summer. And again, this year we're focusing on how owners and directors can prepare their staff for the important responsibilities they have ahead. So David, thank you again. And we'll talk soon.
All right. Thank you.
All right, everybody. Take care.